Good afternoon, everybody. I'm going to talk about Spider Silk project. The main aim of Spider Silk is to design an innovative military helmet concept. This military helmet must be super tough, super light, and must be resistant to the smallest and highest energy fragments. The concept we are going to propose is based on bio-inspired solutions. Spider Silk project has been divided into two teams, mode team, team A, safe team, team B. Mode team approached the problem from an analytical, theoretical point of view. They began their analysis with the overall design of the helmet shape and external shell. Then they moved into the internal ergonomics and comfort analysis. Defined the global solution, they then try to apply to find other fields of application of their concept, their solution, external to the military field. For example, other helmet typologies, but also completely different fields, such as architectural resistant problems. For example, the roofs, hail resistance roofs. Safe team approached the problem from a numerical predictive point of view. Through this method, they managed to define an optimization of the global structure of the shell, of the external shell of the helmet, in a way to increase the resistance, reducing the material usage. Then they also optimized the external surface of the helmet. Together with Mode team, we proposed an innovative ungulated surface. They applied this idea to the overall design of the helmet. We, as a safe team, analyzed the effectiveness of this kind of shape against projectiles and fragments impact. Of course, if we propose something so innovative, we have also to face the problem of feasibility. Technical feasibility, we have to reach the highest quality standards, and economical feasibility. The product must be competitive on a future market. Now, let's have a look on Mode team work.
Okay, I'm Bethany Neigebauer from the Mode team, Team A. This is just a little introduction to all the members of our team who are all present here today. We then have our principal academic tutor, Professor Nicola Pugno, as well as other academic tutors, as well as our external tutor, which comes from AMET, which is a high-end engineering company. So let me go ahead. So just a description of where we started with our project. Obviously, coming from a theoretical approach, we wanted to really understand the problems that were in front of us with regards to designing a more efficient and lightweight, as well as regards to strength, helmet. So we kind of started with four general goals, which are seen here. So we had a military helmet as a case study, so generally understanding the existing conditions of military helmets. The second is analytical study and elaboration of ballistic impact, so just understanding how this physics and this phenomena happen and work. The design of padding system and shell shape, so just essentially designing the actual helmet itself, which with regards to the design and the shape. And then finally, concept extended to additional users and application, as we'll later see, which is trying to extend our work to other fields of discipline to see how it could go beyond our very specific genre. So we started out with user requirements. So we have three general user requirements. Obviously, most important is mechanical resistance. So we need to have this be extremely strong and safe, obviously with regards to impacts, not only of bullets, but also blast wave perforation. We then go to weight. So obviously, we presume that as something gets heavier, it usually gets stronger. But we have to consider that these soldiers could be using this for many days at a time or for at least long periods of time. So weight can be extremely important. And many, as we'll see on the numerical side, many that exist in the field today are extremely heavy. And so for long-term use, they're extremely difficult to use. We also have the ergonomics aspect, which is our final aspect, which also this has to be comfortable. Again, being used for long periods of time, you have to be able to move very easily and be agile in the field. So we went back to, obviously, the state of the art and just understanding not only the history but also currently where the field stands today. We started with the history of actual helmets. Obviously, like many helmets in other athletic fields, they started for very simple leather and brass and then ended up with steel. And then finally, we have the materials that we use today around the world, such as Kevlar and titanium. Also important, something that sometimes is disregarded, is the padding system inside of the actual helmet. So this is good to know, is that over 100,000 American soldiers had TBI. TBI is traumatic brain injuries. It's really important to note because these are things such as concussions, for example, that not only are a temporary condition, but also can create long-term mental issues through life, which we'll see later on. Also, with regards, these are a few of the examples that we see today in existing helmets. Skydex is an example we are able to sort of follow as a template with regards to our own design because it's a multi-layered system of padding and therefore more protective. Then we look at also with regards to the state of the art for analytical modeling and understanding how this phenomenon with regards to the impacts of a bullet to an object, in this case a military helmet, functions. So a projectile dissipates kinetic energy equal to the projectile, work to win the target material resistant force. This is important to note because through our research we discovered that not only is the research, it's very vast and complete, however it's not very organized. And in general most studies are very specific to one very specific material. So it becomes really difficult to use it as a general model for other materials in the future. So for us, we wanted to create our own model that we could then eventually use for other materials to test on for ourselves, but also our work can then be used in the future for new materials that we don't even know about today. And then back to the beginning. So our name obviously comes from being inspired by spider silk. However, the way in which spider silk is created by actual spiders, they're a cannibalistic animal, they're cannibalistic insects, so they can't actually be kept in together without eating one another. So that's obviously an issue. And also, it's very fine, and so you need quite a bit of it to make any actual product. So it's just not feasible to use it in real life. So we use that as a general inspiration for our overall material. However, following that, we went into more nature-inspired solutions. So the first of which is the explosion chamber of the bombardier beetle. Essentially, to protect themselves, they have an explosion of acid, which then can hurt an enemy. However, happening within themselves, it also can hurt them. So they actually have an undulated surface within their shell that allows for that to dissipate that energy and not have direct impacts from the explosion. This is something that we'll see later on in our own design. We also have the exoskeleton of the Polypetra cynegalis, which is a fish that is very... It has subcompartments that are multi-layered and there are several of these subcompartments. And so what that does is it allows it to have a very complex and strong material of its actual exoskeleton, but it's still very mobile and agile and able to move very quickly through the water for obvious reasons. So it's something that for us was extremely inspiring and we were able to use it in our final design, which we'll see further on. With regards to our actual analytical model that we came up with, Flavio is going to take over for a second and walk you through that.
So our first concrete efforts focused on the generation of an analytical model describing the phenomenon of perforation of the bullet into a single-layer homogeneous material. We first started with the formulation of the resistance force opposed by the target during the penetration. This equation that you can see here was found in literature, but had some parameter that had to be assessed, in particular N1 and N2, depending on the nose shape of the projectile, and A and B, depending on the materials involved. And in particular, A and B had to be assessed by means of a theory called cavity expansion analysis. This expression was inserted into the Newton's law, and integrating the resulting expression, we finally achieved our first result, that is the depth of penetration of the projectile into the target material. This is a really important result because it allows us to predict the penetration depth just knowing parameters like the materials of the projectile and of the target, the initial kinetic energy of the projectile, and the geometry, the nose geometry of the projectile itself. And in order to fully exploit this first result, we decided to expand this model to a multi-layer structure because actually what we usually find in a personal armor and safety architecture is a structure composed by multiple layers or different materials. So here are just some examples of the application of our model to a two-layer structure. On the left, we have a structure with two layers of aluminum, and on the right, we have a structure with a layer of steel and a layer of aluminum. In the first two graphs in the upper part of the slide, we see the residual velocity of the projectile during the penetration versus the thickness of the two layers. Of course, increasing the thickness, the residual velocity of the projectile decreases until eventually becoming zero, so without penetration happening. But at the same time, of course, increasing the thickness also implies increasing the weight of the final structure. And so we also decided to compute the weight of a potential helmet shell made up of this kind of materials, as you can see in the two graphs in the bottom of this slide. Once we computed the study on the homogeneous materials, we decided to move to the composite materials. These materials are made up of woven fabrics of high-strength fibers immersed in polymetric matrices. And these materials show a really high resistance penetration, but at the same time also really reduced weight. And this is why they are however widely spread in this kind of sector. The problem with the previous model I've shown is that that one was not applicable to this kind of materials because they are not homogeneous and they have not isotropic properties. So we had to develop a new, more flexible model. And this time we started with an energy approach. We started from the well-known principle of energy conservation, considering the initial kinetic energy of the projectile dissipating in both work to win the resistance force opposed by the target material, and thermal energy that heats up the region of the target interested by the penetration phenomenon. Expression for some parameters like the specific volumetric heat or the final target temperature were found in literature. While regarding the resistance stress of the target material, at the beginning we chose a constant value that was equal to the failure tensile strength of the target material. But when we performed the validation of this model with these features I just described, the results were really unsatisfying, and so we had to refine further the model, and we decided in particular to substitute the constant value of the resistance stress with a value that was proportional to the velocity of the projectile as a viscous friction of an object moving into a fluid, and proportional to the compression yield stress, and not anymore the failure stress. With this kind of modification, our model turned into a not linear differential equation that required a numerical solution. But this time, as you can already see in this graph, the results of the validation were really satisfying, because we just computed the projectile depth of penetration varying the initial projectile kinetic energy, and the results of the experiment, the experimental results that we have found in literature were really close to the model results that we found. So, giving the really good agreement that you can also see here from the graphic, we decided to use this tool we generated in order to perform the first step of the concept selection phase, that is the choice of the material. In particular, we decided to use this tool to compare the penetration resistance of the most advanced composite materials actually available into the market or still in phase of development, but at the same time without neglecting the feasibility. So we also decided to compute the weight of a potential shell made up of these kind of materials. And the materials that finally have shown the best compromise among penetration resistance and weight were Kevlar, N5, and Xylon. That actually is a result that agree with what we found previously in the state of the art. I would also like to say that the tool we have generated is important also for the possibility to study new composite materials in the future, to develop and optimize new materials, not only in this field that we have chosen, but also in other fields, as we also will see later in the presentation. Now, Bethany will take over again to present the following steps of the concept selection.
So when we go back, obviously with regards to material, we had to follow a very sort of linear analytical model to find that mathematically. So we had a little bit with regards to material, it was pretty set on what to go with. We just found the results and went with that for materials. However, with regards to the structure and the actual shape of it, we were able to have a little bit more flexibility and sort of, again, take nature as an inspiration. So when we're looking back at the bombardier beetle that I already mentioned, obviously it was extremely good at absorbing actual explosions, which are similar to what we see for blast waves. However, we wondered as well if this could be possible for bullets. So understanding that undulating surface, that corrugated surface that they have in their existing shell in this insect, we decided to go and actually test that in real life for bullets as well. So we were able to actually go with and collaborate with Team B on this to use many of the numerical information and technology that they had available to them that we did not. So we worked with them to find, and we'll see in their presentation as well, we had steel plate targets that were flat and those that were corrugated or undulated. So looking back at it, we actually found that it was true that the undulated were more efficient with regards to actually not having direct impacts and better deflecting that energy. So when we go forward, we begin to actually see the concept selection for the actual padding system. So this system will start from the outside to the inside, starts with deflexion, which is extremely good for absorbing that energy and deflecting it outward, so we have that protection from the actual exterior of the helmet. Then when we go on the more interior, we have Velcro available. One of the most important things for helmets is they're generally made in mass production, obviously, and we need more customability, because if a helmet isn't actually used properly, it doesn't mean anything, it's not efficient. So the Velcro allows for you to change the movement and the location for each individual soldier to have their own personalization. We then go into the actual padding, which is also customizable, as we'll see. So first we have all the layers are of a polyurethane foam, and then we have a gel absorb, which actually helps, again, to absorb that energy and to dissipate it, actually in the padding system, which is better for blast waves and not for bullets. We also have Kevlar as well, which does the same and accepts that energy. Again, there can be a maximum of 3 padding, and that padding depth can change, and the number of padding can change, again, to be specific to each of the soldiers that are using the helmets. When we go on, we see our first concept. So we generally came up with 2 final concepts. The first is one general piece which is a little bit more expensive, we'll see, than the second option with regards to production due to the way that it's the modeling in which it's formed. It also has the possibility to remove the ear protection if you need greater hearing, if you're in a certain situation in the field. However, that can be re-put back with regards to added protection. There's also the possibility of integrating a face shield, which we'll see later on. We actually will use inspiration of possibly having that be a protective face shield, as we see, for example, in motorcycle helmets. However, that also we considered could be a way to produce or sort of provide information to the soldier while they're actually in the field of important things with regard to where they are. In addition, we have the presence of an additional protection plate, which can be taken off from the helmet and attached to the neck to add protection. But using the exoskeleton idea, we again see that it's extremely flexible and allows for that mobility that a soldier requires in any situation. And as you'll probably notice, it's an undulated surface, which we again took from the Bombardier Beetle. We looked at concept two, which is our preferred concept. We see that it's actually an upper shell composed of two distinct connected parts. The way that they're composed and the design of them actually allows them to be more efficient and also less expensive with regards to production. So we have, again, an overlapping shell design creating an integrated vent providing. So this, the way that the two overlap, they actually allow for passive cooling, and so circulation of air within the actual helmet, which is extremely effective and helpful for any weather situation. Again, we see the removable ear cover and information visor possible, as well as the removal of an additional plate that can protect the neck. So just a little 3D view to get a better idea. So we see, again, the chin strap, and as I mentioned before, the padding is adjustable via Velcro and also the depth of the padding, because we found that actually through our state-of-the-art research that the best position is to have it be 1.5, the top of the visor would be 1.5 centimeters above the eyebrows. So again, this allows for each soldier to personalize it to make it the most efficient for them. So going on, we found that in research especially, we were able to use a lot of inspiration from other helmet designs. So first of all was American football helmets, which with regards to TBIs, traumatic brain injuries, were extremely helpful. It's estimated that 80% of professional American football players have TBIs during their life, and actually I'm from the United States, and 2 weeks ago we had an American football player that committed suicide and also killed his girlfriend. So, and they've related it to brain injuries that were caused by concussions during play. And they've had several other professional players that have committed suicide as well. So it's a long-term issue. It's not just temporary injuries. They're things we see throughout their entire life. In addition, we learned from the way that they actually test American football helmets during play. So they have six sensors that are located within the helmet to actually see how not only the helmet but the head reacts to an impact at the moment that it happens. In addition, we have motorcycle helmets, which were useful for understanding because they have to react very quickly to high speed. In a crash, you have very high-speed moments of compression with regards to the helmet. So we were able to learn a lot from that and understanding how speed can also be implemented into our own design, as well as the protective visor, which does more. It allows quite evasive visibility, obviously necessary, but also can be protective against any facial injuries. Also, other athletic helmets were interesting as well, which are extremely diverse. We have everything from bicycle, skateboarding, equestrian, hockey, etc. So finally, we kind of, again, wanted to see how far can we go with this project, because we have I think it was an issue for us at the very beginning of sort of getting out of this very specific, very oriented, discipline-oriented topic. So what we did is actually push that even further and saw how other disciplines are extremely in need of lightweight, strong materials as well. So for architecture, we actually had anti-hail roofing designs. Hail is actually a phenomenon that doesn't happen very often, but when it does, there can be extreme damages, especially to architecture. So using studies from Australia, Switzerland, and the United States, we're able to come up with a design that actually uses a lot of the principles that we use in our own helmet design. So we see a standing seam metal roof that's also undulated, which is currently existing. They do have some undulation in the currently existing roofing systems, but the more that we have that, the more we're able to not have direct impact because of hail on the roofing system. In addition, we suggest slanted. However, this can be implemented on existing buildings that have flat roofs as well. So that's what makes it nice. Obviously, it's extremely applicable for new construction, but it's something that we can also use later on already existing buildings, which is obviously the case in Italy. In addition, we have a composite membrane. So it's a more complex membrane that you see in typical buildings. This membrane will be obviously inspired, so it's lightweight, and it's actually inspired by the same materials we use for the helmet. In addition, we have a few other aspects, such as having a thicker polyester strain insulation, just allowing for that to take more impact without having a direct risk to the actual roofing structure and therefore the interior space. And then finally, we have the existing structure, so we don't change anything to the overall structure, so it can be used on existing buildings. And this also was done a little bit in collaboration with an American firm, which I work for, so we're able to see if it'd be more useful in the actual field. Just some final considerations to go back to see where we came from. So, again, we just started as nature as a source of inspiration, using that as a challenge. We then moved on to problem studying, definition of the problems with regards to military helmets and how they actually exist today, identification of actual and potential stakeholders, so seeing who's involved. Finally, obviously, the most important, user needs and requirement, those that have to actually use it, don't just produce it. And then state-of-the-art analysis, understanding the history of these helmets and also where they exist today. We then approached the problem with a theoretical modeling of projectile target interactions, which we mentioned, and then design methods for shell shape and padding system optimization. We then obviously moved on to solution generation based on all the research that we did over time, with parametric studies, material analysis and choice, structural and geometric modifications, and a padding system and shell design. And then finally, the technical impact and alternative uses of really extending our work beyond our specific concept or beyond our specific genre and going to sports and motorcycle helmets and then obviously to architecture, to building preservation. So just a last thank you from Team A, specifically to our professor, Nicola Pugno, to AMET, who's here today, and also to Alto Scuola Politecnica, who obviously we needed to do this. And now Francesco will take over to do Team B.
Okay. Now let's talk about safety in part of the work. I've said that safe team approaches the problem from a numerical predictive point of view. Why this choice? Because through this method, we managed to firstly acquire full knowledge of all the phenomena involved in an impact event, in the impact event in which we are interested. Then there is a material saving, both during the testing part of during the design process, because there are less tests, then also for the final production of the material, because through optimization given by the numerical procedure, we can save materials in the last part of the production. Then other two points are important. Through the flexibility of modeling, we have the capability to compare a wide range of possible materials and choose the best for our solution. In the end, we can also compare the influences of a huge number of different parameters, so different degrees of freedom, and understand the influences of each parameter or combined parameters. This is computed aided engineering, and we have been followed in this path by AMET SRL. The first step to propose our solution is to understand the user's requirements. Of course, there are some unavoidable requirements to satisfy. We have to save lives. So, safety and resistance is the first requirement. Resistance, in particular, we have to increase resistance, but we have also to take care about comfort and lightness. With Motin deeply addressed the problem of ergonomics, we are going to focus on the problem of lightness. We are trying to reduce the helmet weight. Then other two points, technical and economical feasibility. We have said in the introduction, we have to reach the highest quality standards and to get a competitive product on the market. Finally, model flexibility. This is a pure design requirement. We need a flexible model. That means, for us, an easy-to-use model, a quick model, and a model applicable to each material we want, from traditional materials, innovative materials, but also future, today, and existing materials to understand the best characteristics we need for our product. The second step to propose then our solution is to understand the state of the art. Today, military helmets are based on standards. NIJ standard is a British standard, is the most used worldwide standard, and level AAA is the baseline of today's military helmet, and we are aligning our solution to this baseline. Then other features are important, of course. The external shell. The external shell is the main part and the resistant part of the helmet. It is made today of composite materials, mainly Kevlar. It has got a weight between 1.3 and 1.6 kilos. That means very, very heavy. And it has got a flat and smooth external surface. Then ergonomics and comfort. With Mo team, they talk about paddings, internal paddings, suspension systems. They also modeled the overall design of the helmet to increase, for example, the field of view, field of hearing. But, of course, the point, one of the main points is the need of lightness to reduce that 1.3, 1.6 kilos we have said before. But one of the fundamental points of the state of the art is materials, composite materials. Composite materials are materials made of fibers and matrix. Fibers are the resistant part of the composite material. They give the structure and the resistance. Resin gives the solidity to the part and the final shape to the part. So to increase resistance, we must focus on fibers. There are traditional reinforcing fibers, innovative reinforcing fibers. From traditional, we have carbon fibers, glass fibers, aramid fibers, like Kevlar. Innovative reinforcing fibers, we have this aggressive name, Armos, Dyneema, Technora, Tuaron. Why have we chosen these kind of materials? Because of these two points. We need low density. To reduce weight, we need to reduce the density, but with high resistance, so high tensile strength. And here we can see Armos, Dyneema are the best for specific tensile strength. With low density, we need also high toughness. High toughness is the capability to absorb energy. Of course, this capability is given by tensile strength and strain the deformation. If we want to increase this toughness, we can choose the material with the highest tensile strength. This is good for us. But we are limited. We are constrained on the deformation, on the strain, because we don't want too high deformation. It can be risky for the soldier. So, low density. We need materials with low density, high strength, high toughness, but low strain. The final part of the state of the art is to understand the production processes. Production processes, interesting for our application, for the application of composite materials to helmets, are three. These three: pre-impregnated composites, prepregs, compression molding, resin transfer molding. We will show you how the resin transfer molding, the RTM process, could be the most interesting for our purpose, because it permits to reach the highest quality standards we need. It permits a high accuracy because with this process we can have a full control of the whole process, from the starting point of fibers orientation to the injection of resin to the outside, so governing the thicknesses and the density of the material. Now we are ready to enter our solution. Our solution is bio-inspired, as we said. Spider silk, bombarded with an explosion chamber. For the spider silk part, we have chosen this idea, this concept, for these three main reasons. It is a composite material, like ours. Then, it has got a high toughness. It is one of the toughest materials in the world. The problem of spider silk, of course, is that toughness is given both by high tensile strength, but also by high deformation. So we cannot apply directly spider silk to our solution. We can be bio-inspired by it. Then, the final point is the structural optimization. Spider silk toughness is not given only by material, but also by the web, the overall web structure. So we have to translate this concept to our solution and optimize the fiber structure on our helmet. Second point is bombarded with explosion chamber. As my team already described, they applied the design concept to the overall design of the helmet. We are going to measure, to verify the effectiveness of this shape, the effectiveness of this shape against projectile fragments. Other studies have been performed before us, verifying the resistance of such a shape against blast explosions, but this is an innovative analysis, the measure of how this shape is effectiveness against impacts. Now let's have a look on the first of the two concepts, application.
So let's go now deeper into our solution. We talked before about flexibility of our model, how we can obtain it and then to really save in experimental tests. We have many ways to approximate our reality with our model. A first way would be, for example, the adoption of a really sophisticated model, like the woven fiber is. This implicates the use of solid elements for modeling both fiber and both matrix. But this method, as expected, is not suitable for large-scale model and large-scale sensitivity campaigns. So we have to shift to a continuum equivalent model, that is a more approximated model, but not this doesn't mean that is a less accurate model, because this continuum equivalent model can be modeled both with shell, solid, or fixed shell elements. For example, we choose fixed shell elements available in LS-Dyna that let in the each integration point to define or matrix properties or fiber properties, obviously in the respective direction. Above all variable materials in LS-Dyna, we choose the light blue curve ones because it's one of the main more complex models available in LS-Dyna. In the animation, you can see the behavior in tension, compression, and shear of this kind, provided by this kind of model. And seeing the animation, you can identify the main governing parameters among all, that is the peak strain, the corresponding strain to peak stress, the strain at failure, and also the residual strength after peak. And this is very important because it defines the amount of plastic work that our plate is able to dissipate. Each layer is modeled then with one element thickness. The overall model is made up of n number of layers linked together with the adhesive. Let's go further, and then we can then go deeper into the model properties. The animation is a typical layout of our results. First, we can see that obtaining results provide a visual correct visual evaluation of the phenomena, and this is very important because in numerical analysis is one of the main aspects we have to see. Secondly, let's go now deeper into the lamination, that is a very important phenomena in impact on multilayer targets. Looking at the governing law, we can see that this reminds to mixed mode fracture mechanics, but with the difference that we have not to face with fracture energy, but simply with the limit stress. In particular, NFLS is the normal failure stress, so normal to the into the direction orthogonal to the plate. Instead, SFLS is the limit shear strength of the adhesive. This is, for us, for our opinion, very important in the saving cost, because if you want to evaluate adhesive parameter, we don't have to actuate complicated and very expensive test that aimed to find out fracture energy of the adhesive. Also, we have to say that these tests are not yet standardized. So, and also their evaluation in dynamic phenomena is not so simple. Given that, the adhesive parameter was shown to be very important in defining failure mechanism of our plate. Not mainly due to the fact that the adhesive and so the lamination is able to dissipate energy, because we found out that the large amount of dissipated energy is due to plastic work, but due to the fact that, for example, a Nike value of the lamination parameters can shift from a ductile, let's say, behavior into a punching fragile behavior of the plate. So the residual velocity in the two cases is completely different. Regarding the material, what we find out in the sensitivity analysis, we find out that the most influencing and benefits parameters to overall response are high maximum strengths, high strain at peak stress, and also high strain at failure. That defines, obviously, the toughness. But, as said before, we have some limits in the ultimate strain because an excessive buckle of the AMET is unacceptable. Also, let's see at the energy balance of numerical simulation. Who among you is familiar with numerical simulation and knows the importance of energy balance? It's clear. The total energy is constant during the transient. Hourglass energy that is related to some spurious energy deformation mode is limited into under acceptable levels. And then kinetic energy and internal energy are correctly related. Let's go going on. We talk about a model that is flexible, but what we can do to save materials and so save weight. We also made some parallel analysis on undulated shape of the surface, borrowing the explosion chamber of the bombardier beetle. Here in the slide, there are some of the many results and the many simulations we performed. Obviously, we made a comparison between undulated surface and flat surface that has the mean thickness in order to perform a significant comparison. What's the main results of this analysis? That when the wavelength of the undulation is comparable with the fragment or projectile dimensions, there is a general improvement in performance. That is translated into a lower residual velocity. Here we have flat target. Here we have several undulated target, which equation is this, and then the parameters that goes into the equation are in the table. So very similar among them, but we found a general improvement. We also analyzed the extreme case of rigid surface, but obviously, as expected, the V-notch discontinuities causes a stress intensity intensification. And so the overall response is even worse than the flat target. Going then on other requirements, what is our answer to the request of comfort? Our answer is on the structural side, more the team focused on the padding system. Instead, we focus on the saving of the weight. The undulated surface, and as seen in the previous slide, can approximately improve the performance in terms of residual velocity of about 40%. Then, on the safety side, we can translate it in a 40% of saving in material. That is, for example, if we decide to adopt a traditional material like Kevlar is. Kevlar is the most used material for current military helmet from USA Defense to Canadian ones and so on. We obtain that the overall structure is made up of 68 layers and 6.8 millimeters of thickness. These are only numbers. The important number is this one, about 700 grams. If you remember the initial numbers, there were 1.3 and 1.6. We have to add that there are some weight provided by the padding system, some electronical devices that can be added to the helmet, but they can be estimated in about 300 to 400 grams. And so the overall weight can be around 1 kilo, only by adopting the optimized shape, maintaining a traditional material. Obviously, if we decide to use innovative materials, we can obtain the better performances, but we have to take into account more costs, obviously. What about the technical feasibility of the new solution? We analyzed the different production processes. Let's go directly to resin transfer molding, because it was really the only possible to apply to our, applicable to our project, because it let us to obtain the high quality standards. It lets us to control the fiber volumetric fraction, that this was another parameters we found to govern the response. So the more fiber volumetric fraction, the more is the plate resistance. We have full control and design of the resin flow, so we can avoid voids, and voids are unacceptable in our product. And also the possibility to implement the corrugated surface. Other production processes do not let to obtain this shape. And also for some aspect provide our responses. For example, pre-impregnated give bad results because there is no overlapping between the fibers of subsequent layers, so a lower friction, a lower benefit friction among layers. A more focus on resin transfer molding regarding the economical feasibility, we cannot say that is most expensive or cheapest than others. The costs are comparable among the all methods. We underline that is the only method we can use. Also, we estimated that a production from 1,000 to 10,000 of devices per year is the best. Provides a best balance between cost. These are quite easy tasks to achieve because one helmet is used not only by one defense, but is used by several national defense according to some agreements. So our solution provided a solution from the conceptual design to final production. The build numerical model correctly represents all physical aspects, and so is suitable for allows sensitivity campaigns and different materials. Structural optimization is a key point because let to use traditional materials saving in weight. So we can save weight or at the same weight improve the performance. LTM is shown to be suitable for our project, for our product, but several numerical studies are required to perform the resin flow, and maybe our AMET companies may be interested and also competent in this analysis. Also, the found results are not strictly required to the particular device, but can use in a more general way to retaining device, protection shell for nuclear plants, or underwater structure. So thank you. Let me bring some few seconds to thanks also the representatives of the AMET company because their collaboration was constant and also stimulating for the development of the project. Thank you.